For part three, let's explore hypothesis testing for P. Remember P from confidence intervals? That was a probability or proportion or percentage. We're trying to figure out if the true percentage is more than a number or less than a number or not equal to a number. We're using this procedure if we're dealing with large samples. If we deal with small samples, kind of like what we did with our when we did our sample size of three, when we played the carnival game, we can actually calculate it manually pretty easily to find the p-value, just like I showed you in the introduction to hypothesis testing. So when I say large samples here, I actually don't mean 30. When I'm saying large samples, it's really going to be a completely different rule. It's not going to be n greater than or equal to 30. It could be, but it's can be a lot. It could be wind up being a lot more than 30. Okay, so let's go through some examples here. Before we start off, though, let's talk about what we need. First off, when we're dealing with hypothesis testing for proportions, we're going to set them up. Assuming our population comes from some binomial distribution. Really, more specifically, we need a clear success, a clear failure, and there must be some probability of success that we're interested in finding, some p. And remember, this is a different p from before. This is not the p-value. This is a population proportion. It's a population parameter. So we're going to start this off by saying p is equal to some claim, some number, and our HA could be right tail, left tail, or two tail test, just like before. As far as how large is a large sample, and the reason why we care about this is because we're going to use the Z distribution as an approximation of our sampling distribution, and it only works if our sample size is large. How large is large? We really need N times this hypothesized proportion to be at least 15. And you also need n times the probability of failure under the null hypothesis to be at least 15, where this q naught symbol is just 1 minus p naught. So if, let's say, p naught was 0.3, q naught would be 0.7. You need both of these calculations to be at least 15, or this whole z distribution approximation won't work. Okay. So how it's done. Really, you can use either the alpha p-value approach or you can use the rejection region approach. Either one will work. The method is almost identical to what we've been doing when we've been testing the mean, except as we saw, our HO looks a little different. Instead of mu equaling a number, it's going to be p equals a number. That's very important, by the way. Make sure you actually put a p here. All too often, I see students on tests writing mu equals because it's just you're used to it at this point. It's p because we're dealing with proportions. All right, so the HO, HA is going to look a little different because we're dealing with proportions. We're going to calculate a z value, but the formula for the z looks, well, quite a bit different, actually. Instead of x bar minus mu over the standard error of that sampling distribution of x bar, it's going to be p hat minus p, or p under the null hypothesis, over what's called the standard error of the sampling distribution of proportions. Really, this is the same standard error as what we saw with confidence intervals, but instead of p hat and q hat in here, we're dealing with p naught and q naught, our hypothesized proportions. As far as calculating p hat, we're going to do it the exact same way as before. We're just going to take our number of successes and divide it by our sample size. Okay, so let's use it. Again, it's going to be the same procedures as before, just how we calculate the Z is different and how we write HO and HA is different. All right, so this is actually a real example. This was originally published in Chance Magazine, but it's also one of the examples in your textbook, or one of the questions, exercises. So Chance Magazine reported on a study done with 121 volunteers. About half these volunteers were given a red gummy bear to munch on, and about half were given a yellow one instead. The volunteers were blindfolded, so they didn't know which gummy bear they were given, and they were asked just on taste to guess the color. Well, 97 of those volunteers guessed correctly. So let's test at the 5% significance level if color and taste are related to each other. So to start this off, we have to do a little bit of critical thinking, and we realize that if color and taste are completely unrelated, then we'd only expect 50% of the people in any sample to get it right, or 50% of the people in our population, I should say. So our HO would be that taste and color are unrelated, so P would be equal to 0.5, and our HA would be that they are related to each other, which means the proportion is not equal to 0.5. Before we actually get too far along in this, we want to check our assumption. We'll want to make sure that this is the right kind of test we should be doing. So we need to make sure our sample size is large enough. And remember, you can't just say, oh, 121 is greater than 30. It's fine. We actually have to do a calculation here. So P naught under HO is 0.5. And that implies that Q naught, which remembers the probability of the complement, is just going to be 1 minus 0.5, which is still 0.5, because 50%, the complement is going to still be 50%. So N times P naught is 121 times 0.5, which is 60.5. And N times Q naught is clearly going to give you the same number in this example. Since they're both greater than or equal to 15, which was our cutoff value, though truth be told, if it was 14, it'd still be okay. But let's just pick a number and stick with it, just like we did with 30 from before. So since both of these are at least 15, yes, we have a large enough sample to proceed. All right, so let's continue our example. This is a two-tailed test, since HA is P not equal. So just like before, if we decide to do the rejection region approach, we're going to start off by drawing our rejection regions on both sides. Okay, since our alpha value was 5%, we're going to split that in half. And half of 5% is 2.5%, or 0.025. So 2.5% are in each tail, which means our Z alphas is really, or Z alpha over 2s, are going to be the Z alpha over 2s associated with a 5% alpha value for a two-tailed test. Remember, there was a table I gave you in the last section that gave you those Z values, the critical Z values you need. But you might also remember this from confidence intervals. If 5% are in the tails, 95% is in the middle, which means we'd have 1.96 and negative 1.96 as our cutoffs. All right. Alternatively, if that's a little confusing, you can actually still use the t-table here. You just use the infinity line from the bottom. All right, the infinity degree freedom line. Okay. Anyway, so no matter how you decide to do it, our z is 1.96 and negative 1.96, and these are our critical values, our cutoff values. Next, we need to calculate our test statistic and see if it falls in the region. So our test statistic, remember the formula is different now. It's p hat minus p naught divided by the square root of all of this, p naught, q naught over n. Make sure all of this is inside the square root. That is the most common mistake students make with this calculation. All right, in order to do this formula, we need to know what p hat is, and p hat is approximately 0.8. You'd want to avoid rounding if possible. I eventually had a round here, but try to avoid rounding as much as possible until the very end. So if we plug in our numbers, we're going to get a Z of approximately 6.64, which is huge, right? We're saying that our sample proportion fell over six standard deviations above the hypothesized proportion. So this is a very unusual situation. Really, it would be off the slide. It would be somewhere over here. But I'm not too concerned about scale. I just care about position. So I'll just draw my test statistic over here at 6.64. So since it clearly falls in the rejection region, our conclusion is that we're going to reject HO. And in other words, at a 5% significance level, there is sufficient evidence that color and taste of gummy bears are indeed related to each other. People can actually predict the, since it's on the positive side, people can predict the color of a gummy bear based on its taste. are based on its based on just taste alone. For our last example, this is a made-up example, but it might mimic what an actual business might do. But this time, let's do the alpha p-value approach, since I said you could use either procedure. So suppose a telemarketing firm wants to reduce the percentage of people that just hang up within the first minute of a phone call. So for the last year, the percentage of calls that ended up in a hang-up within the first minute they found was 94%. So they decided to do some changes because they thought 94% was too high. So they decided to rewrite their script and change their target demographics, basically change their marketing scheme. So they monitored the calls over the past over the last month, and there were 7,580 calls made during that month. 7,110 of those calls resulted in the potential customer, or a victim, whatever you want to call it, hanging up within the first minute. So is there evidence that the new marketing strategy is effective? So we want to know if the strategy is effective, which means we want to know if it reduced the percentage of hangups. So we want P to be less than 0.94 if the strategy is going to be effective. And so HO, remember, always is an equal to sign, so it would be P equals 0.94. And again, be very careful here. Make sure that you're writing P equals, P not equals, P less than, whatever. But remember, these have to be P's over here, because we're talking about making some conclusion about the proportion or percentage in a sample. So before moving on, let's check if our sample size is large enough. Well, the sample size is pretty huge, as you can see. It's pretty clearly going to be large enough, but just to check. Well, there were 7,580 people in our sample. 94% of those people would be a little over 7,000, well, a lot over 7,000. That's clearly at least 15. And 6% of 7,580 is, again, clearly over our number 15 that we need. Since both are more than 15, the sample size is clearly large enough. Okay, so to continue. We want to start off. We already identified HO and HA, so for step two, we need to draw the distribution and calculate our test statistic. To calculate our test statistic, as you saw before, we need to calculate p-hat, which is going to be approximately 0.938. It was pretty close to that, so I just rounded there. But again, you want to try to avoid rounding as much as possible. So plugging in our numbers into the formula, remember p-hat was 0.938. Our p-naught value is the p-value associated with HO, which is 0.94, and our q-naught value is the probability of not that, so it would be 1 minus it, which is 0.06, same number we used down there. All right, so plugging in our numbers, we get that the test statistic is approximately negative 0.73. That's not very large. So we can probably tell right away this is not going to be significant, but let's go through the motions anyway. All right, so this is not super important, but remember we are dealing with a p-hat distribution here, so make sure that you label it that way if you want to be precise. We're drawing this distribution as if HO was true, so it's going to be centered around 0.94. We're dealing with the alpha p-value approach. So because of that, we're going to calculate our test. Well, we already did calculate our test statistic. We want to do that right away, and we want to draw it right away. So remember, our p-hat, our proportion, our sample, was 93.8%. And our p-value, this was a left tail test, so we're going to shade to the left. And our remember, our test statistic was negative 0.73. So this part here is going to be our p-value. We can calculate this on the table. And remember, the table gives you between 0 and z. So going to our table, we're just going to look up 0.73. So 0.7, go over to 3, gives you 0.2673. So writing that in would be right over there, and our p-value is going to be 0.5 minus that. So that's 0.2327. So our conclusion, since alpha is actually far less than our p-value. Actually, I just recalled, I never actually even gave you an alpha value. If you look on the first slide, I didn't give you an alpha value here. I just forgot to. If I ever do forget to give you an alpha value, just make one up and clearly state it. So I'm just going to state that the alpha value is 10%. Remember, that's my willingness to be wrong. It really is the tester's choice. So there's nothing wrong with that. All right, anyway, so our alpha value is, well, really any value, alpha value we would have chosen anyway, is going to be less than our p-value. So we're going to fail to reject HO. The fish is smaller than the pond. Fail to reject. So at a 10% significance level, there is insufficient evidence that the new marketing strategy was effective.